A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
He hung his head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory.
The soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, "Truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior."
He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ and Lord.
Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside. Now in our hearts we know he died to save us from our sins.
Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah! The risen Lord be with you and also with you.
placed alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross as Jesus died, and the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on him was laid. Darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again. As he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, born with the precious blood.
We now prepare ourselves to confess our sins and receive afresh God's forgiveness, saying together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil, and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. God, who is both power and love, forgive us and free us from our sins. Heal and strengthen us by his Spirit and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. We are here in joy and praise, giving glory to you, saying together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And now we pray the Collect, the special prayer for today, the second Sunday of Easter. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace, to the praise of God the Father. Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Acts, beginning to read at chapter 4, verse 32. This is headed, "The Believers Share Their Possessions." All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. I am the first and the last, says the Lord, and the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive for evermore. Alleluia. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. John chapter 20, verses 19 to 30. Glory to you, O Lord. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, My Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Morning, everybody. It's great to be with you on this second Sunday of the Easter season. Let's pray together. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him and say that we love him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. Amen. Certain people are sometimes referred to as household names because of who they are, what they do, or they've become famous for something. So, for example, in the world of sport, if I say the name Pelé, even if you're not a football fan, the chances are that you will have heard of the legendary Brazilian. Mention Walkman Wise. Because their shows are still regularly on TV, people of all ages know that they were brilliant comedians. Or there's Dame Helen Mirren, the wonderful actress who starred in so many different roles since her stage debut back in the 1960s. And I suggest that these so-called household names are mirrored by characters we meet in the Bible, again because of who they are, what they're known for, but also the ways in which, through encounters with their Lord, their lives have been transformed. So from the Old Testament, say Noah, and you'll probably think Ark. If I say Jonah, and you'll think of his big fish experience. Or Samson, whose haircut when he was asleep led to pretty drastic consequences. Perhaps that's a warning for those of us looking into ahead to having our lockdown hair dealt with as hairdressers open again soon. Or from the New Testament, we have Zacchaeus, the vertically challenged tax collector whose life was turned around as a result of an encounter with the Lord. And of course there's Mary Magdalene, the first witness to the resurrection, the apostle to the apostles. And speaking of resurrection, our focus today from the Gospel reading from St. John chapter 20 is going to be on a man who I suggest for 2,000 years has really been pretty unfortunate when it comes to what you might call his household name. The New Testament gives him several names. Thomas the Apostle. He's also referred to as Judas Thomas. In our reading as Didymus, the twin. But never in the pages of Scripture is he referred to as Doubting Thomas. But even people who don't know the story of what happened on the Sunday following the first Easter day use those words, Doubting Thomas, to describe anybody who is sceptical, who refuses to believe something without direct personal experience. But not only do I think Thomas is unfortunate, I also believe it's inaccurate to sum him up in this way. It doesn't do justice to who he is or what we can learn from him. But before getting into his story and experience a little bit more, and as a kind of backdrop to what follows, I believe it's important to say that we often confuse doubt with unbelief, and they are not the same. Unbelief describes an absence of faith, a refusal to believe something or someone. Maybe shades of that grumpy old television character Victor Meldrew and his catchphrase, I don't believe it. On the other hand, doubt is when you may want to believe, but for various reasons are not sure that you're able to. There's uncertainty, you need to be convinced. And I accept that those words do describe what was happening for Thomas in today's reading. But I also want to say again, there's a lot more to him than that. From my own personal experience, along with many conversations I've had with different people over the years, when it comes to doubts about God, they can kick in and be there for a whole number of different reasons. But let me share a story that focuses on one of those reasons and powerfully and indeed painfully illustrates what can happen if doubt and belief or unbelief are confused and there isn't space for honest questions. It happened when I was Bishop of Bolton. I'd been welcomed as a guest to the Thursday night prayers in one of the mosques in the town of Bury. Towards the end of the evening, I was surprised, though delighted, to be invited to the front to share something of my own personal faith journey and then pray a blessing on all those who were assembled. This was followed by curry, and I found myself sitting cross-legged on the floor opposite a young white man, but was in traditional clothes worn by a Muslim. So after some general conversation, I asked him if he'd mind telling me why it was that he'd embraced Islam. He said he was happy to do so, and cutting a long story short, he told me he'd grown up without any faith, but that as a teenager he'd started to explore, ask questions, search. And one day he took those questions to a church, spoke with a minister, who suggested that he should read through St. Mark's Gospel, inviting him to come back the following week. I thought that was pretty good way to begin. And the young man told me he duly read the 16 chapters, and when he then came to meet with the minister, he told him how he'd been really drawn to the person of Jesus. He found him deeply attractive and compelling. But he said, "I've got questions. I can't understand how he can be the Son of God. I just can't get my head around that." To which the minister replied, "Well, if you can't believe that, there's no point us continuing this conversation." You know, friends, I could have wept at that moment when I heard those words. In fact, I did shed some tears when I got in the car later. And the young man went on to say, "So I tried the local mosque. They were ready to listen and take my question seriously." And before I could say anything else, and I have to tell you, I was pretty lost for words anyway, he said, "But I want you to know, Bishop, I love Jesus and I read the Bible every day as well as the Quran." How differently his story might have ended had his questions, had his doubts been taken seriously by that Christian minister. So let's go now back a bit into Thomas's story and fill in the picture a little bit more. Because you see, there are three occasions in John's Gospel when he features, and each one of them teaches something about him. He's first mentioned in chapter 11. There's a message about an urgent crisis at Mary and Martha's home in Bethany. Jesus heads off to Judea in response to this, which leads to the raising of Lazarus from the dead. Now, knowing it would be dangerous for Jesus to head in that direction because the last time he was there, some of the crowd threatened to stone him, most of the disciples suggested this was a crazy thing to do. But what does Thomas say? "Let us also go that we may die with him." Now, some people suggest that this perhaps means, you know, was Thomas a bit of an Eeyore kind of a character? If you're not familiar with Eeyore, he's the pessimistic and rather gloomy old grey donkey who is a friend of Winnie the Pooh. But it's my conviction that, yes, he knew the danger that lay ahead. And what his response is to Jesus demonstrates that he was actually pretty brave, pretty courageous. So rather than doubting Thomas, could we actually call him Courageous Thomas? The second time Thomas is mentioned in John's Gospel is in chapter 14. The description of that final meeting in the upper room with Jesus and his disciples prior to his death on the cross. And then amongst the wonderful words that Jesus speaks, he tells them that he will be going ahead of them to prepare a place for them. Now here Thomas is the person in the class who asks the question everybody else wants to, but they don't want to demonstrate their ignorance. Never been in that position. Or maybe you're the person who has put their hand up in the class. And here, like my friend in the mosque, Thomas shows himself to be an honest, questioning, passionate seeker of the truth. As he says, "Lord, we don't know how you're going, where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And from that honest question come some of the most beautiful and important words from Jesus' lips. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." Now, aren't you glad Thomas put his hand up that day? Call him doubting if you like, but I thank God for honest Thomas. And friends, God loves our questions. He loves our honesty. He loves our wrestling with things. And church needs to be somewhere we can do this asking and this wrestling, not a place where such things are off limits, were criticized or were still condemned for having questions and doubts. So I give you courageous Thomas. I give you honest Thomas. And now we come to the third time he appears in John's Gospel, which is found in the second part of our Gospel reading this morning. The first few verses have described how the risen Jesus gobsmacks the disciples with his appearance on the evening of that first Easter day, bursting through the locked doors of the room where they have met, and bursting through the locked doors of their fears. But Thomas wasn't there, and as a result, he missed Jesus. So why wasn't he there? We can only speculate, but like all the others, he'd been on an emotional roller coaster. He'd seen his friend, he'd seen his Lord, for whom he'd left everything to follow, crucified like a common criminal, and then was now dead and buried. Any of us who have experienced grief can find it hard, can't we, sometimes to be in the company of others. Sometimes we just need to be alone, to have that space, especially if we think there's any danger of them feeling all upbeat and jolly. We just need to be on our own. But whatever was going on, bearing in mind what I've said about his courage and honesty, when the other disciples come to him and say, "We've seen the Lord," he isn't willing to accept that possibility secondhand. And so it is that he says, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my fingers where the nails were, put my hand into his side, I won't believe it." But here's the thing, and this is really important. It's not so much that Thomas ever doubted Jesus. His doubts here were because of what the disciples were saying about Jesus, the claims they were making. There's a difference. And as we go on to hear, when Jesus appears again, gives them the peace, before anything else, he speaks directly to Thomas and gives him an invitation. "Okay, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand. Put it into my side. Don't be faithless. Believe." Now, we're not told whether or not he actually took up that offer, whether he did or didn't need to. But we do know what his response was: "My Lord and my God." And you know what's brilliant about all this? Each of us comes to and grows in faith differently. The late Bishop Richard Hare, who was one of my mentors as a young vicar, had a number of sayings, amongst which was this: "God loves to do the same thing differently." The same thing is to bring us to a knowledge of himself, but the means by which that happens is rightly different and unique for each of us. And so as we read the whole of chapter 20 of John's Gospel, John, the apostle, the author of the Gospel, comes to believe as a result of seeing the empty clothes. We then come across Mary Magdalene, and it's as Jesus calls her by name that she knows who he is, that he is risen. And now for Thomas, it's something different, the invitation to touch Jesus, out of which he then makes this most beautiful profession of faith. He's the first person to call Jesus God, "My Lord and my God." Doubting Thomas, maybe, but I'd rather think in this instance of Thomas the confessor. And by being honest with his questions, if you like, he went from the surface of faith to the summit of faith. Jesus knows what each of us needs. He knew Thomas had a questioning mind, but he knew that he had a loving heart. And he knows that we all need different means of letting us know that God is real. I read these words earlier this week. "When the bottom drops out of your life, when the pain of circumstances seems unbearable, when some shattering event occurs and doubt marches in unannounced, acknowledge it." That was what was going on for Thomas. Times of doubt can become classrooms of learning when they drive you to God for answers. And you know, Jesus speaks directly to each one of us at the end of this encounter. If this were a film rather than a book, I think this would be the point where Jesus' head turns from Thomas's and looks directly down the camera lens and says, looking each of us in the eye, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." That's you. That's me. Or it can be, if you haven't yet taken the Thomas step of saying, "Jesus, my Lord and my God." Thomas, the courageous, the honest, the one who first confessed Jesus as God, did get to see For him, seeing in the end was believing. But friends, the wonderful thing for us, including with everything we don't yet understand, we still have questions about, is that a commitment to believing now will one day lead to seeing. As the Apostle Paul puts it in those wonderful words in 1 Corinthians 13, now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I only know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known.
Let us declare our faith in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, saying together, Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen.
For our prayers this morning, when I say, Jesus, Lord of life, the reply is, in your mercy, hear us. Lord, we thank you for those who give us an example to live by, especially Thomas, as we've heard of this morning. But we especially pray today for our Queen, who sets us such a wonderful example of living as a Christian, but who will be mourning today at the death of her husband. We pray that she and her family will know your comfort and strength, and will be left in peace to reflect and remember. We echo the prayer of the Church of England. God of our lives, we give thanks for the life of Prince Philip, for his love of our country and for his devotion to duty. We entrust him now to your love and mercy through our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us. Lord, we thank you for the example of courage we see in Thomas in facing difficulties. We pray for that courage in our leaders as the world continues to experience many issues. We think of the inequalities that the COVID pandemic has exposed and worsened between countries and between communities. Whilst we're so thankful for the vaccine rollout in our country, we pray for those countries experiencing high infection and death rates. We pray too for areas where there is injustice and unrest, far across the world in places like Myanmar, and on our doorstep in Northern Ireland. Lord, give our government and the Stormont leaders the wisdom and grace to overcome old hurts and divisions and restore order to that country. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us. Lord, we thank you for the example Thomas gave us of not being afraid to ask questions. We pray that as local elections approach, we may be ready to look at our society in the light of your teaching and to ask hard questions of our politicians and candidates. We pray that those elected will bring integrity and wisdom to their roles, and we thank you for all those who work to maintain and improve lives in our city on a daily basis. We pray for teachers as school resumes on Monday, for NHS workers, for those working in the care sector and those who provide other essential services. We thank you for the effort that's been made to trace cases of COVID in this city and to encourage people to accept the vaccine. And we thank you that we can see the results of that in the lowering of case numbers. We pray too for our Muslim friends as Ramadan begins, that you'll build their faith through their fasting and help them to find ways yet again of celebrating without meeting up. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us. Lord, we thank you that Thomas was amongst the first to hear and respond to your calling, and we thank you that we too have responded to that call to follow you, and we pray that you will daily deepen our faith and help us to live our lives as you would want us to. As our society gradually opens up after lockdown, we thank you that our church has been able to open all the time, but we pray now that you'll show us new ways of safely meeting up and spending time with friends and family. We acknowledge that there'll be a range of feelings about the increased freedom. Some will be anxious and others can't wait to get out there. Help us to be sensitive and understanding to one another and encourage each person to resume life at their own pace. We pray for all our team here at Holy Trinity Idol, Anne Rose and Greengates, that in the coming months you will guide us and inspire us to see how we can best support our local communities and church members as we emerge into the new normal. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us. Finally, Lord, we thank you that Thomas received your peace. Lord Jesus, we ask for that peace for ourselves and those we love and pray for. After all the disciples had experienced in the Easter period, the fear, the disappointment, the bewilderment and confusion, you were there for them, bringing peace and blessing. So come, Lord, into our fears, anxieties, confusion and pain, and let us receive your wholeness and peace. Jesus, risen Lord, in your mercy hear us, accept our prayers, and be with us always. Amen.
If you are able to do so, perhaps you would like to stand as we now share in the peace. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. And so let us now offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Shalom, shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom, my child. Shalom, shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom, shalom. Shalom, shalom. God of our journey, as we walk with you on your path of obedience, sustain us on our way and lead us to your glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Lord of all life, you created the universe where all living things reflect your glory. You give us this great and beautiful earth to discover and to cherish. You give us your love even when things go wrong. Jesus knew hurt and pain. Through him you wipe away our tears and fill us with your peace. You made us all, each wonderfully different, to join with the angels and sing your praise, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We thank you, loving Father, because when we turned away, you sent Jesus, your Son. He gave his life for us on the cross and shows us the way to live. Send your Holy Spirit, that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us Christ's body and his blood. On the night before he died, when darkness had fallen, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, he shared it with his disciples, saying, This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me. After they had eaten, Jesus took the cup of wine. He gave thanks and shared it with his disciples, saying, This is my blood, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Christ is the bread of life. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come again. So, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate his love, his death, his risen life. As you feed us with these gifts, send your Holy Spirit and change us more and more to be like Jesus, our Saviour. Help us, Father, to love one another as we look forward to that day when suffering is ended and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. For honour and praise belong to you, Father, with Jesus, your Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. In the words that Jesus gave us, let us pray for the coming of his kingdom. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. And we pray together. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Amen. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, risen from death, we praise you for changed lives and new hopes at Easter. You come to Mary in the garden and turn her tears into joy. For your love and mercy, we give you thanks. We praise your holy name. You come to the disciples in the upper room and turn their fear into courage. For your love and mercy, we give you thanks. We praise your holy name. You come to the disciples by the lakeside and turn their failure into faith. For your love and mercy, we give you thanks. We praise your holy name. You come to the disciples on the Emmaus Road and turn their despair into hope. For your love and mercy, we give you thanks. We praise your holy name. You come to us, your people, now, and turn our weakness into triumph. For your love and mercy, we give you thanks. We praise your holy name. And so may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make us perfect in every good work to do his will, working in us that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us and remain with us and all those whom we love and care for from this day forward. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
shine.